Michelle Roberts, and today we are going to be studying Romans chapter 10, verses 1 through 15. If you do have a quarterly, we will be on pages 77 through 85. Now, the title of our lesson is going to be Saved. So, you know, earlier in Romans, Paul talked about the spiritual responsibility of believers, and after talking to the Gentiles, now Paul wants to return to his fellow Jews and talk to them about being saved. And that's going to lead us up to Romans 10:1. But before we go any further, I would like to ask you to let's go join together our hearts and our minds and let's talk to the Lord together. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we love and adore you. I pray that you take our minds, our souls, our bodies, and help us to focus on this lesson, on your scripture, and meditate on it. I pray that you teach us your word today, and may we hear your word and apply it to our lives that we may glorify you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. So as we said, you know, Paul was earlier talking about spiritual responsibilities of believers, and now he's returned to his fellow Jews to talk to them about salvation. And that's where we're going to read Romans 10, verses 1 through 4. So join with me in Romans chapter 10, 1 through 4. Brethren, my heart's desire, my prayer to God for them is for their salvation. For I testify about them that they have a zeal for God, but not in accordance with knowledge. For not knowing about God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own, they did not subject themselves to the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness for everyone who believes. So here in verses 1 through 4, we see again where Paul expresses his heart's desire is for what? It's for more and more of his fellow Jews to be saved. So now this is going to bring us to Romans chapter 10, verse 5 through 15, where we're going to see that there are three important facts that Paul shares with us. The first important fact that Paul shares with us is he wants you to confess and believe. The second is everyone can be saved. And the third is to tell all about Jesus. Well, let's look at that first important fact that Paul tells us. It's to confess and to believe. And we're going to find this in verses 5 through 10. So let's look first at verse 5. For Moses writes that the man who practices the righteousness which is based on law shall live by that righteousness. Now, some people may try to be righteous by keeping the law of the Old Testament, but you know what? If they have even one slip up, one little tiny failure to obey, say the Ten Commandments, well, that's where the problem lies. Those who think that they can earn righteousness themselves by keeping the law. But no one is perfect except Jesus Christ himself. Even the most zealous, and I'm going to say self-righteous Pharisee, could not keep all the laws. Now let's look in verse 6 and 7. But the righteousness based on faith speaks as follows. Do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven? That is to bring Christ down. Or who will descend into the abyss? That is to bring Christ up from the dead. Okay, this can get very confusing, but basically it's saying righteousness of faith is from divine grace from God. You know, no one human being can possibly bring about the Messiah's incarnation or even his resurrection. Only God can do that. And basically that's what these verses are saying. We can't do that ourselves. Only God can. In verse 8, but what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart, that is, the word of faith which we are preaching. So verse 8, salvation is through faith alone. Faith alone in Christ, and that's true to all who hear it. Now, we're going to look at verse 9 now, that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. So now we're going to look at three words. We're going to look at the words confess, believe, and heart. We see all three of those words in these verses. First, let's look at the word confess. As a Christian, every single thing you do and say needs to be in agreement with the truth that Jesus is Lord. You know, when you speak any words or sounds, those words send out a vibration that go out into the air, and scientists tell us that those vibrations last forever. They never cease vibrating. They just go further and further and further apart. And I don't, not, you know, my dad had a CB radio, and I know he could pick up signals here and there and vibrations on his radio. So, you know, someone could pick up what you're saying way on down the line, because those never stop, those vibrations. So think about that. You know, if you let something come out of your mouth that you want to take back, you can't take it back. Trust me, I've had many words I've wanted to take back, but you can't. But not only can you not take them back, they go on and on and on forever. So why not let those words as a believer be words that glorify God and that speak the truth of Jesus? Now, in verse 2, the second word is believe. And I know I say this a lot. The Greek word for that is pistuo. And we do not have a good English word for that. Some words just do not translate from one language to another well. And this is one of them. So I have researched this word, and it means faith. It means commit to believe in Jesus is to commit to Jesus. To have faith in him is a firm persuasion in him. The third word I want to look at is heart. The heart is the seat of emotions. It's moral decision making. You know, the word heart is used in the Bible more than 800 times. But not one time out of those 800 does it refer to a physical pump that moves your blood around. It just sounds good to us, doesn't it? That, well, you know, it's from the heart. But the Greek word for heart, and there's several different words for this, but the one I want to pick out, the Greek word for heart is guts. The meaning is guts, and that's your central wisdom or feeling as opposed to your head feeling. So we tend to understand this feeling more when something bad happens. So something happens and you just feel it in your gut. It just doubles you over. You're sick to your stomach. You feel it in your gut. That's your central being, your gut. That's where you feel it. And that, when you know in your heart, you know with everything in you, your entire gut, that that's the Lord's word or the gospel's true. So use your gut feeling. And heart is also, it's a deep love, a deep compassion, deep understanding. It's life-giving. You know, the word heart is a very complex word when used in the Bible. So what are you to do with these three words? What are you to confess and believe in your heart? What are you to confess and say with your words that go on and on and on forever, and commit to believe, to commit to in your heart, your gut? Well, the answer is that God raised Jesus from the dead, that he is your Lord and Savior. Now let's look at our second important fact that Paul tells us. He tells us that everyone can be saved. Verse 11, let's look at that. For the scripture said, whoever believes in him will not be disappointed. Whoever believes, whoever commits to Jesus as Lord will not be disappointed. Verse 2, for there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord is Lord of all, abounding in riches for all who call on him. You know, there's no distinction between Jew and Greek. Now, this doesn't mean that we can't have our own culture, our own language, our own tradition. It simply means that there is one way to salvation, and it is offered to all people. Now let's look at verse 13. For whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. So what does it mean? Calls on the Lord. Well, it means surrender to the Lord. Commit to the Lord. Commit to him to be saved. Now we're going to look at a third important fact that Paul tells us. He tells us to tell people about Jesus. Verse 14, how then will they call on him who they have not believed? How will they believe in him who they have not heard? And how will they hear without a preacher? Now don't misunderstand this. This isn't telling you to come across a lost family member or friend and take them to your local preacher and let them witness to them. There's nothing wrong with that. But here he's telling you to be the preacher. It's not talking about the pastor of a church. It's talking about a proclaimer. You are to proclaim Jesus to everyone you meet, everyone you see. So a preacher is a proclaimer, not just the pastor of your church. You are the proclaimer. In verse 15, how will they preach unless they are sent? Just as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring the good news of good things. It is our job to proclaim the gospel of Jesus. It is our job to also send and equip others to share the gospels. We have missionaries that we send. We financially support them. We encourage them. We pray for them. It is our job to do that. Now, that's not your only job. I'm not saying go and send missionaries and your job is done. You too are a proclaimer. You are to tell people about Jesus. But then in return, you're also to help encourage and support those who go to other places to tell about Jesus. So in conclusion, we are saved. We who are saved are to have faith and be committed to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Then we are to confess to all people, to everyone. And how can we be a witness right now when most of us are isolated in our homes? Well, you know, you still get phone calls, don't you? I know I get plenty of phone calls from solicitors, and you can actually witness to those people. They're calling your house. Don't think of it as a phone call. Think of it as that person God has allowed to come into your house through the telephone. Witness to him. Hey, I'll listen to what you have to say, but I want you to give me a few minutes and hear me first. And tell them the Roman road is a good way to start. Tell them about the gospel of Jesus. Now, another way, you know, a lot of you have Facebook. I see people sharing scripture. Scripture speaks for itself even. Post scripture on Facebook. Tell friends about it. Call someone that you know and say, hey, I just wanted to talk to you today and see if, you know, what's your relationship with Jesus Christ? Have you ever committed to him? Send someone a card. Send someone a Bible. There's lots of ways that during this isolation, we can still witness and proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. So my prayer for you this week is that you find new and creative ways. I challenge you to witness to someone this week. Thank you.